As individuals, we might feel small and insignificant in comparison to the stars and the scale of our natural environment. However, our collective society has gained immense power and has permanently changed the face of the Earth through the development of our communities. We have largely gained this ability for widespread development through the utilization of an amazing fossil fuel-based resource, referred to as black gold, but more commonly known as petroleum.
Throughout my time here at the College of Integrated Science and Technology, I've learned how to analyze and solve problems in a variety of different fields, namely energy and environment. In addition, in my geographic science classes, I've learned how to think about problems within a spatial context. What I want to do is I want to apply these problem-solving skills to our current community development paradigm. I want to find out how oil is being used to shape the future of our developments. The first step in order to do that is to have a conversation about peak oil and to have a conversation about economics.
Yeah, this prediction was first proposed by King Hubbard in I believe in 1956. They drew it with a bell-shaped diagram, and they added the total amount of the one that we know we have a good certainty and the one that we think we have it in the future, and that's is going to give you the total amount of oil that we think we have. And many people, when they talk about peak oil, they confuse is it peak in depletion, is it peak in production, is it peak in oil discoveries, but they're missing the point. The bottom line is a finite amount, and that finite amount will be depleted sometime in the future, sometime in the near future. Oil consumption will be increasing. Population is increasing here in the United States, the rest of the world, and the rest of the world, they want to be industrialized. So that's associated with an increased amount of energy consumption. So we're all going to be fighting for the same pie. So limited amount of oil, strong demand, two possible outcomes out of it. One, which is a natural one, that the price of oil is going to increase, or we're going to be fighting for the same pie. I expect in the coming year, you'll be paying easily $4.50, $5 a gallon of gas.
Dr. Altai highlights the important fact that we may disagree about when or if peak oil has already occurred, but we can all agree that oil prices will continue to rise. The question becomes, how dependent on oil is our current subdivision development paradigm? I went to my local community in Crozet, Virginia to investigate.
Let's observe what we have in this neighborhood. We have large houses, large front lawns, a driveway, and a two-car garage for each house. But say we are not in a car. Now what do you not see? You don't see any sidewalks or any bike paths. This means that if I lived in this community and I wanted to grab some milk from the store or get a Redbox movie, I would have to drive the entire 0.4 miles to get to the shopping center across the street.
Citizens who live in subdivisions such as Quarry Farms only have one option when it comes to going to work, going to school, or going shopping. They can't walk, they can't bike, and there is no form of public transportation. They have to put gasoline in their car and drive. In this current development paradigm, we are not providing our citizens an energy-efficient means of transportation.
I think the United States in general is very bad at that kind of planning. We will say, okay, we can put 700 houses in the middle of a rural area. It's as far away from the public schools as you can get. It's a great distance away from the highways that take people to work. It's a waste of fuel. It's a waste of energy. It's about the worst planning that you can do. Unfortunately, a lot of planners don't have these things in the forefront of their thinking, and they ought to be in the forefront of their thinking all the time. And if it isn't in the future, we are really going to be suffering.
If we continue our reliance on the type of fuel consumption that we've been doing now, things are going to get worse if we keep keeping people on the roads like we do now. So, yeah, that can be hard. That can be a challenge to have to get people to think on a larger scale.
Because right now, what we're seeing is a disconnect between our knowledge of peak oil and the realization that this fuel is going to run out, and the way that we continue to develop our landscape where houses and communities are spread out. It almost mandates that people need to drive their car. And so we really need to rethink this so that our future development happens in a way that is more sustainable, where people can live, work, and play in a community that's a bit more close-knit, where people don't need to get into their automobile to get to where they need to be. So one of the things that tends to happen is if people feel like these environmental issues or conservation issues get forced upon them, and that really, you know, rubs against the grain of a lot of people's beliefs in American freedom and our value system. And one of the most beautiful things about our country is that we are free to make our own decisions and to do what we want to do. And if we try and push these ideas or this new thinking, or this new paradigm onto folks, there's going to be a resistance, and rightfully so. So what we need to do is to think about how to make this development happen in a sustainable manner with all of these smart growth considerations. And so you need to make these communities attractive and desirable places with things that people want to have nearby. And that includes shopping and restaurants and a lively downtown area. But what you're really driving at here is creating an environment that people want to be in so that they will choose to be there, that they will choose to move their families into the city instead of choosing other options that are there for them. And if you can make this environment a really desirable place to be, then people will choose to go there, and they will reap all of these other benefits that are good for them and their family, and also good for the community at large.
In this energy-efficient smart growth concept, what we want to do is make our downtowns attractive places to live, so citizens will be encouraged to move back into them instead of moving them out into suburbs. In order to see if this is happening in reality, I went to the neighboring town of Waynesboro to investigate.
Born and raised here. I like the quaintness and the smallness. Well, downtown's not what it used to be, but we had a Leggett's down here, and four or five eating establishments, and four or five dress shops, and just a lot of bustle and hustle going on. So hopefully it will get back to being a little better than it is now. We got some empty storefronts, and we're just waiting for some of the other stores to be rented and people to move into them. In the west end out at the town center, you know, the new development's out there, so businesses are going there instead of downtown. It's within the city limits, but, you know, it's 5 miles from here. And you got Target and Kohl's and Walmart and all that stuff, big stores. Now, the little mom and pops are still down here. You know, people are going to go out there and get off the interstate and stop there instead of coming downtown.
Let's take an aerial look at Waynesboro and analyze the issue that Weber highlights. Here is Waynesboro's downtown area, and here is where all the new commercial development has occurred. From a spatial perspective, it is apparent that the newer commercial development has economically crippled the historical downtown because it is easier to access from the interstate. This development creates little motivation for people to go downtown and in fact incentivizes citizens to drive away from their own community center.
The commercial development on the outskirts of Waynesboro economically hurt the vitality of the downtown area, making it less attractive, which does not adhere to the smart growth energy efficient principles. However, every single community needs economic development in order to sustain itself. To get a different side of the story, I interviewed developer Keith Smith to get a different perspective.
It's funny, let me see, I guess I've been doing this 25 years, and I didn't realize I was an asshole until my card said developer. And these people I knew my whole life, and whatever, like, well, you're a developer. I said, well, all of a sudden I become an asshole because I'm a developer. I got to figure out a way to get a square peg and round hole and get parties together to have a conversation so we can get a specific project approved and make sure nobody's ever going to be totally happy, make sure everybody's a little bit happy. And then, of course, you got to figure out, does the numbers work? Because if the numbers don't work, then nothing's going to happen. And you kind of have to meld all those. A respectable developer will say, look, all I want to do is know the rules. Tell me the rules. Tell me what I can do. Tell me what I can't do. Make it clean and clear to understand.
Keith Smith makes it clear that developers abide by the laws by which they are governed. Who determines these laws and who determines where and what developers can build? The local city council does, along with the help from its planners. Together, they create a document called the Comprehensive Plan, which is a long-term vision of the community. In addition, they enforce this document with zoning codes and zoning ordinances, which legally dictate what type of building you can build and where you can build it. So let's take a look at what the local government has planned for Waynesboro's future.
The pink you see on the zoning map is where land is zoned for commercial development. Now, if you look at an aerial image, you can see that most of this land is not even developed yet. This means that Waynesboro's problems will only get worse. In effect, the city planners and local government officials are more interested in the short-term economic profit that a strip mall will bring in than forming a long-lasting, energy-efficient, smart-growth community that attracts people to move downtown.
At local government level, it can sometimes be difficult to see long-term outside of your locality. Because when you're looking at a development proposal, you're looking at then and now, this is what's being proposed. So yeah, it can be hard for local officials to get that broader picture and see how that particular development is impacting that, that the broader sense of things.
After being disappointed with the development and planning in my local communities, I decided to hit the road and explore some cities that are better smart growth models. Burlington, Vermont is famous for having a lively downtown area and a beautiful natural environment, so my friends and I decided to road trip up to visit the city. The underlying question becomes, what qualities do good cities possess that attract people to live downtown?
Once you get to Burlington and you go past Church Street and you're going down to the waterfront, there's just a ton of trees. It's all open and the landscape is beautiful and there's lots of paths to walk around and there's a really long bike path that goes all along Lake Champlain and kind of lines the beach area of the lake, and it's really pretty. Also, Church Street is the main attraction of Burlington. I think it has all the bars and shopping and everyone's just super friendly. There's this huge sense of culture and community, and you always see people you know, which is nice. Everything's within 5 minutes of walking if you need anything. I have a ton of friends who live downtown now because they also went to South Burlington, but now they have apartments downtown and they walk everywhere. There's no need for a car at all.
Looking at the zoning map for Burlington, you can see that the planners have created a centralized downtown area and waterfront. It is zoned mixed use, which allows for residential and commercial development in the same area. You can see that the yellow areas around downtown are solely high density residential. In this example, it is obvious how it would be easy to walk or bike everywhere, as most of the high density residential zoning is within 1/2 mile from the downtown area. Ease of access, walkability, a centralized downtown, and an integrated natural environment are what draws people to live in Burlington. The next successful smart growth city on the list was Boulder, Colorado.
Spend my days with a woman and kind.
My girlfriend at the time went to school in Colorado, so we drove out west and took a trip up to Boulder to shop at Boulder's famous open-air pedestrian downtown mall.
Made in my mind, making you start. I'm going to California with an ache in my heart. Someone told me there's a girl out there.
It's small enough where a lot of people know each other. So if you're out walking on the mall, or you know, doing something on the weekend, or out riding your bike, you usually run into at least a few people that you know. It's like it's probably, I don't know, 6 or 7 blocks blocked off, and the street is, I don't know, brick or cobblestone or something. There's shops, and then there's shops that go out for a block or two on the side. And so it's a place to congregate. It's very unique and diverse. But then in the midst of the diversity, you still have like very traditional like community institutions, like the Boulder Bookstore, which has been there forever. And Barnes & Noble is never going to put it out of business because it's the Boulder Bookstore and it'll be there forever. So the community supports stuff like that. The other thing that makes there a strong sense of community is that all the people who live there are all like-minded. So everyone is, you know, it's more cool to walk or ride your bike to work than it is to drive your car. You don't need a car there. I mean, unless you want to get out of town. But I mean, even then, you don't really need a car. They have like a nested bus system. So you have interconnectivity, and based on what scale you want to travel, you can pick the transportation system. The other thing that's interesting is that bikes rule in Boulder. So God forbid you ever mess with somebody on a bike or do something that's like not right in traffic, because all of the bicyclists will call you out on it. Other cars will think you're horrible. So it's like there's definitely a stratified society, and the bikes win. There's young people there. There's people with families there. There's a lot of older people there. I think it's for everybody. It's the only place that I've ever lived in my entire life where I remember waking up in the morning and driving to work and driving west on Arapahoe, and you can see the mountains right there. And just thinking how wonderful it was that I lived in Colorado, and I was so content there, but everybody felt the same way. So you'd be at like a bar or having coffee, and you and the other Coloradans would get into the talks about, you know, we are just so fortunate to live. What a wonderful place. Can you imagine? And we live here, you know? So, I mean, you'd have those talks. It would just come up. So everyone had that sense of just being completely blessed because they lived there.
As soon as I got back from Colorado, I was presented with an opportunity to visit the U.S.'s sustainability capital, Portland, Oregon, in order to represent JMU at Net Impact Sustainability Conference. So I packed my bags, hopped on my bike, drove to Dulles, and finally had some time to relax. Looking out the window, I felt a strange sense of peace. I observed the endless subdivision sprawls below me and entered a state of contemplation. What are we doing as a society? It appears we are busy rushing from home to work to shop to home. And for what? Well, to provide for our families so that we can live comfortable, privileged lives. But, I wonder, is our suburban development really conducive to a high quality of life? Does it really make us happy to sit in traffic for hours each day? Does it make us happy to manicure large front lawns that we don't even have time to play on? Are we really free if we can only do what the local homeowners association deems as appropriate? Do we feel good about throwing ourselves in debt to finance this big home, big lawn, and cars for each family member? And if we finally do get that hefty mortgage paid off, how many of us actually appreciate what we have? How many of us appreciate the fact that we can eat foods that are out of season, have instant access to electricity and clean water, and can moderate the temperature in our homes? Instead, how many of us spend the majority of our day getting stressed out at work or in class, and then spend our free time complaining about what our bosses, teachers, significant others, and friends have recently done to irritate us? How many of us take the time to think about how our actions affect the rest of the world? And why do we feel discomfort when we ask ourselves these questions? I wonder, why do we always have to wait for the economy to dictate everything? The economy is a concept invented by humans, and we dictate it through every single purchase we make. Why don't we step up to the plate and accept responsibility for the consequences of our lifestyle? Why are we not excited that we are powerful individuals who make a difference with each action that we make and each dollar that we spend? I landed in Portland inspired to see what America's sustainability capital was doing to address these issues. The first thing that surprised me about Portland was the amount of trees and green space. Portland has a population around 530,000, and I assumed it would be a concrete jungle like most other cities its size. But on the contrary, it was very open and green. My next surprise was Portland's top-notch public transit infrastructure. Portland is connected by a highly efficient light rail system. The light rail is free to use within the central downtown district, and residents can buy passes to commute from different parts of the city to work downtown. In terms of energy efficiency, the light rail is powered by electricity, which insulates the structure from rising oil prices. The electricity used is generated by hydropower, making it a perfect model for a sustainable public transit system. In addition to the light rail, Portland has a far-reaching bus system that reaches the parts of the city where the light rail does not go, and has bus stops at light rail stations so that you can get almost anywhere in the city without stepping foot into a car. The icing on the cake is that Portland has the largest amount of electric vehicle recharging stations of any U.S. city, so that if you can't live without a car, you can still have an EV without worrying about the rising price of oil. The light rail system is hugely popular and is fully utilized by Portland residents. People have just accepted that's how you get around in Portland and take full advantage of its convenience.
Great public transit. I don't need a car here. I haven't had a car now for 5 years. We gave our car away.
That it's walkable, that you don't need a car. I don't have a car.
No.
So I haven't had one for over a decade. Portland's small enough to feel like it's your town and you can make some change, but still big enough that you can have luxuries of a larger city, so there's still art, there's still, like, you know, things happening.
Portland also has a vibrant city center. While it does not have an outdoor walking mall like Burlington or Boulder, its downtown public space is utilized in a similar way on weekends and becomes an open-air market. Here, everyone can go shopping, mingle, and enjoy the open space.
I love it because the people are nice, it's small, it's not too big. I've been to Seattle, Seattle's huge. I love Seattle for business, but Portland is a great place to be with the family, so it's a good place. Everything's kind of loose, everything's kind of like really mellow. People allow themselves to do things without too much politics, that's what I like about it. And of course, the green, beautiful landscapes and everything is real nice here.
Let's take a look at Portland's zoning map. If you look closely, you will see something extraordinary. It is a thin line of zoning called the urban growth boundary. As you can see, this boundary separates the city from rural, agricultural, and forest land, effectively preventing any urban sprawl. This urban growth boundary is the magic tool that legally enforces smart growth principles by limiting sprawl and development to within its boundaries.
So what do these forward-looking cities have in common? They balance high density with open space, so their urban environments don't feel clustered and claustrophobic. They have highly effective public transit systems, which gives the citizens multiple options for transport. And finally, they have walkable downtown areas that foster a sense of community. These downtown areas make sense if you think about it. How are you supposed to have a strong sense of community when if you just live in a subdivision and you drive to your big box in your car and you drive to the fast food chain at the end of the big box and then you drive home? You're not really interacting with people in your environment when you do that. So when you have a downtown area where people go to hang out, they go to shopping, they go to eat, they go to bars, they go listen to live music, you have more opportunities to interact with the people that live around you, which is what actually creates a sense of community. So now that we know what forward-looking communities are doing, how do we implement these concepts within our own communities? In order to answer that question, we need to take a deeper look at how local government works.
The essence of local government land use planning is, in my opinion, from a planning perspective, it revolves around the comprehensive plan. The comprehensive plan is the central tool that is used to encapsulate the vision of the citizens of the community and how that vision should be implemented. So in the development of a comprehensive plan, you have input from the citizens, the elected body, the planning commission, which is appointed by the elected body. You have planning staff that drives and supports the effort of the comprehensive plan. The comprehensive plan should be run through a series of public meetings and then public hearing processes. It has a vision, it has goals, it has very specific actions for implementation. Once a comprehensive plan has received public input, and it's ready for adoption, the Planning Commission will recommend its approval to the elected body, and then the elected body will adopt it as the official plan. Once the comprehensive plan is in place, then planning staff has a roadmap, along with the community, the citizens, and the board, and the Planning Commission, on what to do, what needs to get done, and how do we need to do it. And that's where ordinances come in, which are the laws of the land to enforce and implement all of it.
Mr. Coffey highlights how citizens and local government officials work together in order to create a vision for the community and steps to implement that vision. With such a democratic, inclusive, and comprehensive model, why is it so difficult to implement change?
Here's the problem. So this group doesn't trust that group because there's a few bad apples in that group.
I'm trying to facilitate something. And one side was a bunch of engineers and accountants, and the other side was some public officials. And they just could not understand one another.
When you adopt ordinances from a plan, and then you have the elected body not want to approve things that are supported by those ordinances, that's where there can be somewhat of a disconnect.
The difficulty under Virginia law is taking a very good plan for your community and converting it into ordinances that actually allow you to do what your vision says you would like to do.
When your locality hosts these meetings for comprehensive plans or for greenways or for schools, the participation levels are almost always low.
You're trying to represent what you think the people want, but frequently it's very difficult to gauge actually what the people do want.
People are very reactionary, and they will come out when they perceive a threat to their livelihood or to their pocketbook or to their children or just to any change that they perceive as being negative. If they don't perceive a threat, if they don't have an issue, then they tend to not come out in mass.
Poor communication, lack of trust, an uneducated public, poor citizen involvement, and a general lack of cooperation from everyone make it difficult to implement change. So what are some strategies we could utilize to address these issues?
That's a hell of a question, because that is the crux of I think what this is all about.
We brought the board in for work sessions. I think it was critical. I think that was our best idea, to invite them to come sit at the table in a joint work session with the Planning Commission with these things on the table.
It's a matter of getting to know one another, in my opinion.
Communication. I think it boils down to communication. Sure that the governing body has all the information it needs to be able to feel comfortable to say yes was our goal. That was our goal. And we did it.
What I try to do to help maximize the success of projects is develop processes for rezonings, for special use permits, for development projects where there's citizen participation in that process above and beyond what is required by state code minimums. And that allows the project to evolve. People can become educated. It's not mysterious any longer.
I figured it would be a good idea for us to get a really large group of Savannah citizens together and in a facilitated setting, find out what they really liked about Savannah County and what they wanted to see it be like in the future. So that was very successful. And so successful that a lot of the written report from that
went into the 2001 comprehensive plan.
Really what I want to have is a conversation with the citizens, you know, so sometimes it's useful just to have work groups. You know, we're going to have a stakeholders work session, we're going to get out some easels and some markers and, you know, let's talk about some of this stuff.
In order for significant changes to be implemented, it's going to take local government officials going above and beyond what is required by state law in order to bring citizens, local planners, and the governing body together and getting them to work on clear steps for implementation. There's a business district called NOMA in Washington, D.C. that exemplifies what we can accomplish if we learn how to work together and set aside our differences.
So NOMA stands for North of Massachusetts Avenue. It's a neighborhood just north of Union Station in Washington, D.C., and it's D.C.'s fastest growing neighborhood. So about 6 or 8 years ago, the landscape around here was pretty much empty blocks and low-lying industrial properties. Although it was just a short distance from the nation's capital, about 8 blocks away, it felt very desolate and ignored. We faced questions of whether we were going to reinvest in cities or kind of go out and contribute to the exurban growth. And thanks to, you know, some of the biggest players in this market, there was a reinvestment in downtown. And the planners were really out front of things along with some of the early property owners in this area. There were these group of developers who owned a lot of land in the area, and they were individually going to agencies selling the vision and going to brokers selling the vision and, you know, tenants selling the vision. And they realized that if they pooled their resources together, they could kind of outsource that job and do it more efficiently and more regularly. So it was really a lot of great minds who were committed enough to the cause to take a big risk and put their money where their mouth was. I mean, that was key. And, you know, there is some altruism to it, but in the end, that marginal sacrifice has, I believe, helped contribute to making more of a profit for those involved. So, you know, it has come back to benefit those who took that risk. So what really turned the tide and unlocked the development potential for NOMA is the public-private investment in a new metro station. Since that station opened, this 35-block, very small geographic area has delivered 11 million square feet of new space, which is, you know, as large as some small cities. So it's really a city within a city that has grown up because of a visionary investment in transit-oriented, mixed-use, high-density development. The first domino to fall for the new NOMA is the office product. So as you walk around NOMA today, you're going to see a lot of beautiful new office buildings that are home to, in part, a lot of federal and DC government agencies, but also a lot of private sector tenants, including SiriusXM Radio, CNN, NPR, Kaiser Permanente, Care First. So a lot of great corporations here, and almost all of them in the new NOMA have ground level retail, diverse retail. One of the features of our community is a Harris Teeter at the corner of First and M, which is not only a great retail amenity for the neighborhood, a grocery store, but also a great connecting point for the community. Right now, as you look around, you're going to see a lot of cranes, and most of those are related to residential buildings being built. All of our buildings here in NOMA are at the maximum density for Washington, D.C. What you often see is parking decks that are half full and bike racks that are double full. And they keep having to add more and more and more bike racks. So we're seeing that as a general trend in Washington, that people are biking to work and home and to fun places, and they're choosing not to have a car because they just don't feel that they need one.
NOMA is an amazing example of what we can accomplish if we learn how to communicate and work together. A group of developers banded together and worked in conjunction with the local government in order to create a mixed-use, transit-oriented community that benefited DC as a whole, but also benefited those who were willing to take the risk and invest in the project. However, NOMA is not simply a template that we can plop down over every single community in the United States, because it has issues with gentrification and affordable housing. Rather, we should focus on getting the different interest groups in our communities to work together and sit down and collaborate in order to solve each of our own unique energy efficiency issues. In order to see more smart growth projects and planning, we need an informed and educated public that participates in the public process. We need local planners and government officials to be able to work together and cooperate, and also incentivize downtown economic revitalization and make it easier for developers to redevelop our downtown areas. Finally, we need developers who are willing to take that risk and invest in that vision. So let's do this. Let's be forward-looking, and let's be proactive, and let's create communities that are energy efficient and beautiful places to be.